Then let's go. So the topic today is the Remmel-Fisher scoring algorithm. And if you go to the Google folder, the lecture script is now updated with respect to Remmel and also the nonlinear optimization stuff. So you can see that in there, wasn't there last week. So the Remmel-Fisher scoring algorithm is the algorithm that is always run when anyone analyzes fMRI data in the framework of the GLM in the world. So it's run a lot of times, although I think most people don't. Well, they should know that it's being run because it's printed to, as we saw last week, it's printed to the MATLAB command window. So it's saying Remmel iteration 1, 2, and 3 and so on, but it's not much talked about, strangely. Anyway, yeah, today we want to then look into how Remmel estimation is actually numerically carried out. But the first thing we want to do is give a little bit of a recap of what we've done so far with Remmel. Once we are again in the position where we have the Remmel objective function and understand what that is, then we're going to look into the nonlinear optimization of, or the, let's say, the numerical optimization of this using what is known Fisher scoring. And Fisher scoring is a variant of Newton-Raphson optimization. So we're first going to look at Newton-Raphson optimization. Once we establish this, and specifically the multivariate form, then we can easily discuss Fisher scoring. And because this is a general algorithm, we then finally have to look at how Fisher scoring is applied to the Remmel maximization. So that's the plan, and once we're done with that, we're actually done with the Remmel business, and after Christmas then get started on stochastic processes and how they relate to the covariance matrices that we are discussing here, and then also the spatial expression of effects, so the random field theory based p-value evaluation. But that's for the new year, so let's start with some Remmel recap. So last week in this one video, which unfortunately was not recorded, or somehow didn't work, we looked at the motivation for doing Remmel, where the motivation, the basic motivation was that the standard maximum likelihood estimator for the variance parameter is biased, so its expectation is not equal to the true but unknown variance parameter. And then we looked a little bit how this into how this bias arises, because in the maximum likelihood estimation of the variance parameter, one plugs in the beta parameters and beta parameter estimates, sorry, and this plugging in of the beta parameter estimates then ignores some contribution to the log likelihood estimator, as we've seen. And so that was kind of the motivation to start with the Remmel business. And another thing that we introduced last time was then to consider now the GLM as it's actually formulated for fMRI data analysis, namely with non-spherical and linearly constrained covariance matrices. So what I mean by this is the following. So in terms of the model that we look at, we now look at a model that has parameters beta and lambda for a data vector y, and this is given by y by a normal multivariate normal distribution over the data vector y, which is of course still our time series of MR signals over a single voxel, which is distributed according to a multivariate normal distribution, and this multivariate normal distribution has an expectation parameter x beta, which is still, of course, our design matrix, which we get from the convolution of the onset functions. Beta parameters are still our effect sizes of the conditions, but the important thing is now that we don't have, as the variance, as the covariance matrix parameter, we don't have this spherical covariance matrix sigma square in, which models independent and identically distributed errors. So that's not the case, but we have this V lambda. And this V lambda we introduced as the sum of covariance component parameters, these small lambda I, and covariance matrix basis functions Qi, where we also have seen that Q1 is always the identity matrix In, so we with lambda 1 being larger than 0, we cover the spherical error covariance matrix, but we can do more. And for example, we've seen that in fMRI, what is often used is this ZT matrix, where Z, where the entries of Z are given by this exponential, this exponential of the distance between J and I, so the row and the column matrix coordinates. And why this exponential, so why this ZIJ matrix is being used, this is what we're going to look at in the new year in January. I want to know a little bit about stochastic processes. So at this point, it's not really meaningful. It's modeling some decaying correlation between the errors. That's what you may appreciate, but really where it's coming from, we don't know yet, but it's fine because we will look into that, and we need some more theory in the stochastic processes to really understand this. The important thing is that this V lambda is now not only the spherical covariance matrix anymore, but possibly more. And then the story in fMRI GLM analysis is that Remmel is now used to estimate the lambda parameters. So in a way, we have Remmel estimate lambda. And then we have a lambda estimate from Remmel. How exactly we get to that, we will see today. And then we can, of course, estimate beta. So in the second step, then estimate beta using the generalized least squares estimator. So basically doing, so I get that correct. So basically by using an estimated covariance matrix in the beta estimator. Another way we can do is, of course, to whiten the data as we discussed in generalized least squares. But that's the overall procedure, and we discussed generalized least squares, and we did a little bit on Remmel, and today we will more, and so we will finish this first step here today. So that's then the overall logic and the overall model, and then we started talking about the idea of Remmel estimation, and the main idea of Remmel estimation is to multiply the GLM equation, which takes in our case, or in this case now, the form this form, to multiply this with a matrix K transpose, where K is N times, sorry, not N times P, Jesus, it's N times R, sorry. And the important thing about this matrix, which is also called error contrast matrix, which is just a name, is that if it's multiplied with the design matrix, it yields the R times P zero matrix. We will never really talk about how this K matrix is found, because what we will see in the end is that we don't actually need this K matrix at all to estimate lambda. So it's kind of a theoretical construct that is put in, but which we never really have to evaluate to actually do ML estimation. When we then multiply the GLM here, so if we take this times KT, what we get is KTY equals KT X beta plus KT epsilon. And the important thing is that this is zero, so this entire product of X and beta is removed, and we get KTY being just KT epsilon. So we in this transformed GLM, we don't have any contribution of these fixed effects, but we just have some transformed residuals. And essentially the linear transformation theorem for Gaussian distributions, we then immediately know that KTY is distributed according to a multivariate normal distribution. Still a typo. I had hope I'd get them out, but there's still one. With zero expectation and with covariance matrix given by the transformed error covariance, namely KT V lambda. Yeah. So this is all now, after multiplying the GLM that we are working with this matrix KT, we get to a distribution of the data multiplied by KT that is distributed according to a multivariate normal with R-dimensional zero vector and covariance matrix KT V lambda K. And the task is then to estimate the parameters of this distribution based on KTY and essentially Y, because K is somehow given, we will not need it, but Y is the data. And the only thing that there is to estimate is this lambda covariance component parameter vector, because there are no beta parameters anymore. Yeah. So because they have been removed. And this is then done using essentially maximum likelihood, but because we have already restricted this maximum likelihood to the case where the beta parameters are removed, this is referred to as restricted maximum likelihood. And the log likelihood function that we are dealing with here, I then denote as LKTY, which is a function of a k-dimensional parameter lambda, gives a, like always, a real number, and takes this form. Which just follows, as you also see in the script, which just follows from taking again the log of this multivariate Gaussian, and then you get to this form. To a second row here so that we see the whole thing. So this is just the log of this multivariate Gaussian, and then viewed as a function of the lambda covariance component parameters. So it's essentially completely the same as in standard and maximum likelihood, but because we have this KTY constraint here, it's restricted. It's called restricted maximum likelihood. And you might miss like for the Gaussian some minus something here, here and here, but this is of course because the expectation is zero, so minus zero R is zero, and this is the inverse covariance matrix, so it's actually quite straightforward. One thing that can be done, and that is where somehow the magic of Remmel is actually happening, is that one can define a matrix P lambda, which has this form. One can actually view this matrix from a Bayesian perspective, but we will not do this. So if we define this P matrix, you see that this P matrix, that there is no K in this matrix, so it's just derived from the inverse of the covariance matrix, so V lambda and the design matrix. The peculiar thing, as I write in the script, is that this matrix P lambda is equal to K KT B lambda K minus 1 KT. And that's actually quite important. So if you look at this, that this matrix, so with the, all the V's and the inverse V's and the design matrix, it's equal to this product of the covariance matrix with this K matrix. It's not easy to see, or at least I don't see immediately why this should be the case. I looked into the mathematical derivation of this, and it turned out that this is actually quite involved. So because there are always time constraints, I decided I will leave this for the moment and not study in detail why this is happening, because it really seems to require some abstract matrix algebra theory, and I just didn't have enough time to really go deeply into it. You find a proof of this identity, so that this V lambda minus 1 x and so on is equal to this k. You find a proof for this in this very nice book by Searle on variance components in an appendix. So if you really want to know why this is true, which is of course interesting, you find this in the appendix M4R of Searle's variance components, but maybe notice that when I looked into it, I found it to require some work for me to understand what's going on, so I don't know what that means for you, but it's very important result in the whole context, because it will then allow us to rewrite the Remmel objective function, or this Remmel log likelihood function, in a simple way. And actually, because of this identity, so that something with the k, namely p lambda, is the same as something that only involves the covariance matrix V lambda and the design matrix, we get rid of K to a certain degree. And so it's important, but it's really mathematically deep. So this is why, although I usually don't do that, but this I take here as kind of a result that we don't prove and we just take for granted. With this result, however, and specifically with this thing here, we can substitute a little bit in the Remmel log likelihood function. So we can basically replace this kt v lambda k minus 1 kt here. So this can be replaced by p lambda, and then we get kind of a simplified version of the Remmel log likelihood function, which is also known as the Remmel objective function. So you often see the term Remmel objective function in the literature. So that then looks like this. And we can replace all this stuff here with this P matrix, so we get to P lambda Y. Yeah? And this here, what I've just wrote down, this is then known as the Remmel objective function. It's of course just the log likelihood function in the Remmel scenario with this P lambda put in. Is referred to as the Remmel objective function. So this function now is a function of lambda, so our covariance component parameters. But these lambdas, they come in, of course, here at V lambda, where they are the weights in this linear combination of basis functions, and they come in here in the P lambda function is in the inverse of the covariance matrix. So the important thing here is that this function is nonlinear in lambda, because it enters through a determinant and it enters via its inverse, both of which are nonlinear functions. And hence, it's not readily possible to solve this as we did, for example, for the beta parameter or the variance parameter in the spherical case. So it's more complex to solve, to maximize with respect to lambda. And what is used here is a numerical optimization method. So instead of having now an optimization, so instead of having a formula like our beta head estimator, which was just a simple formula that we can always apply once we have the design matrix and the data, we now don't get a simple formula for lambda, but we need to basically shift lambda around, and so to maximize the function or the Remmel objective function as a function of lambda. Yeah, so that's kind of the, this is when you see these Remmel iterations in SPM happening. This is when lambda is shifted around until Remmel objective function is maximized. And once it's maximized, then we, of course, have our lambda Remmel estimate, and which maximizes the Remmel objective function. And the question then is, how this numerical optimization is happening. And this numerical optimization of the Remmel objective function, in terms of how it's implemented in SPM, this goes back to two papers by Carl Friston in 2002 and 2003, which discuss that to a certain degree. So this is kind of the best documentation you will find on what SPM is actually doing. I'm not saying it's an awesome documentation, but at least it mentions that Das Rennl, and it provides the Fischer scoring update equations without really discussing Rennl, because it's doing it in a different context. But yeah, that's how it unfortunately is. It would be better if this would be much better explained and much better documented. But what can you do? Yeah. So that's kind of now the aim, to maximize the Rennl objective function. Yeah. And once we have the maximize the Rennl objective function again, then we have our lambda hat Rennl, which is then of course also an unbiased estimator of the variance components, which we can then put into the better general least squares estimator, or we, and this is actually what's happening under the hood of SPM, we can use the estimated covariance matrix to widen the data, so by multiplying with its square root. So, but this is equivalent as we've seen previously. Good, so the aim then is to discuss how now this Rennl objective function is maximized. Yeah? And how this is essentially done in SPM. And this now takes us kind of out of, we are just discussing statistics, but takes us into questions of numerical optimization. So this is why there is now this additional mathematical preliminary section, which is actually just a couple of pages. It's just 4 pages on numerical optimization. Of course, this doesn't cover numerical optimization as a whole. I will, once I get back to finishing the PMFN book, I want to put in a couple of other things into this numerical optimization thing. Right now it focuses on Newton-Raphson, because Newton-Raphson is the precursor to Fischer scoring, and after all, we're, because here we need to discuss Rennl-Fischer scoring. To maximize with respect to lambda. So that's then the main topic actually for today. And yeah, maybe let's just start with some background on numerical optimization. So the fundamental the fundamental aim of numerical optimization is of course to find some maximizing argument. So if you have a function of some theta, so some parameters, you want to find a theta star such that this function f at the location theta star is larger or equal to itself for all theta not equal to theta star. So that's the main aim. Of course, you can easily visualize that and then think of some function that maybe in this form will never really exist. Well, it could be a Gaussian mixture or something. And you want to find the maximum of this function. So this is here f theta. Here you have the parameter space, and of course you see that the maximum of this function here is here, so that's the maximum, and here f theta star is larger or equal to f theta for all the remaining parameters, and then of course the maximum happens at this location. Yeah, so it's intuitively numerical optimization is of course fairly straightforward. at least the aim of numerical optimization is fairly straightforward. You want to find what I call a maximizer or a maximizing value. And of course, this maximizing value of the input parameter of this arbitrary function here f corresponds to the location of the maximum. Yeah. So just keep that because people often confuse that. They say we want to find a maximum, but then they actually mean they want to find the input argument that maximizes the function, and this is not called the maximum, but this is called the maximizing value or maximizer or whatever, but not maximum, because the maximum is the value of the function at the location of the maximum. So that's the aim of numerical optimization. And of course, in our case now, this function that we are here interested in is our Reml objective function. Yeah, so I'm just writing f here to make it a little bit more general, but of course what we have in mind is to maximize our Reml objective function. And then the basic idea of numerical optimization is that you start with some value theta zero, so you come up with some starting value in whatever way, yeah, maybe let's make this in blue. So you start with some starting value, and then you somehow try to have a rule that gives you that based on the starting value gets you to a new value of theta. So for example, here theta one, such that the new value is somehow larger than the old value. So you here get from f theta zero to f theta one. And so you proceed over iterations, so you go theta 0, theta 1, theta 2, and so on, until convergence, whatever that means in a specific scenario, with the aim of approaching the maximizing value in parameter space or finding the maximum. And there are just very many approaches to do that. So one way to do that, which I also have included here, mainly because you hear all about it in terms of deep learning, is gradient ascent. So one, just to briefly mention it, gradient ascent is a specific rule to shift around the parameter based on the gradient of a function. So I assume, because some of who is taking the exam tonight, so whoever is taking the exam tonight knows what a gradient is. The other ones will know it in February. It's essentially the first derivative of a multivariate real-valued function. Gradient ascent is a specific rule to do this kind of parameter search and finding the maximum, and the update rule for gradient ascent is that for the k plus one iteration, so the k has nothing to do with our covariance components now, it's just the iteration counter here, you take the previous parameter and you add to it a learning rate times the gradient of the function at the previous location. So that's the gradient, so the first derivative in theta k. And because the gradient is always points in the direction of steepest ascent, so for example, if you're here, you here have kind of this gradient, so you would go a specific amount in this direction in on the function, which in parameter space takes you a little bit into this direction. The problem with gradient ascent is that you need a what's called a learning rate parameter, so this alpha, and this alpha basically says how far you want to go along this gradient. And of course, if you say very little, then you make very little progress. If you say very far, so for example, you go up to here, then you actually don't even increase necessarily the value. So gradient ascent is in general quite a bad idea if it doesn't have an adaptive learning rate. So gradient ascent in terms of nonlinear optimization is really not the most useful algorithm. It works roughly, and if you basically test a lot of parameters then and always check whether they are at a maximum, or if you're trying to minimize something at a minimum, they still do something, but it's not the most clever algorithm. And a little bit more clever than gradient ascent is actually Newton-Raphson, which we now want to discuss. So that was briefly the general idea of numerical optimization, which of course in terms of people working in science, I think people like numerical optimization more than analytical optimization, because you don't have to think that much. So in terms of numerical optimization, you have kind of an algorithm that finds you the maximizing value of a function. And if you want to do analytical maximization, you have to actually do what you always need to do. You evaluate the necessary and sufficient conditions for a maximum. This was actually an important point that I forgot to mention. What you always try to do in terms of maximization is that you want to find a point that satisfies the necessary condition for an extremal value. So you always want to go to location such that the gradient, so the first derivative of the function, is zero. So this is what you want to find, because if you look here at the maximum, the derivative is just the slope of this tangent line, and that's zero here for this kind of global maximum. But of course it's only the necessary condition. So you also have for maximum, you also have, actually have this as local minima, and you also have this at local maxima. So it's not really any proof that you found the global maximum. You also have this at saddle points, but it's a easy to check indicator. And if things increased while going there, and then you are there, and the first derivative is zero, then this is usually a good indication that you had a maximum. I forgot to say that you can of course do more sophisticated things and also look at the second derivative, but specifically if you have multi-value functions, this can be a little bit complex. So the basic check is always that the first derivative is zero. Now, Newton-Raphson. Newton-Raphson is kind of a little bit more advanced approach compared to gradient ascent. And the aim is here to maximize a function f. So I'm starting with the univariate Newton-Raphson approach. So you have a function that is a real-valued univariate function. And the aim is to find a zero of its derivative. Because if you are let me first write it down by finding zero of f prime. So the motivation here is that if the first derivative is zero, then you are at an extremal point or saddle point. But usually if you have functions that are well behaved, for example functions that have a square and that are the negative of a square, then from finding a zero of the derivative of the first derivative, then you are likely at a maximum. Yeah. So if one really wants to do this mathematically more rigorous then one would have to study the properties of the functions and make sure that for the functions that you apply this to, it actually holds that if the first derivative is zero, that you are at the location of a maximum. So, and for most of the functions that we are dealing with in statistics, you actually can do this, but of course this requires more theory, so we will not discuss this in detail. So we are happy with the intuitive idea that, okay, at a maximum, the necessary condition is that the first derivative is zero. So if we find a zero, so basically by a zero, I mean, of course, a point f theta star, f prime theta star, where this is zero. If you find a zero, then you are at the location of a maximum. So that's kind of the idea. And to do this, the idea is to use a first order Taylor approximation. Again, people who take the exam today know what that is, and also should know. So there's still time. To look at the first order Taylor expansion of the derivative, which I actually denote here with this little tilde thing, so that it's clear that it's not the derivative itself, but an approximation to it. And this first order approximation is done in the expansion point theta k. So we assume that we know some value for the parameter, which can of course be then our starting value of the algorithm, and we approximate the derivative of the function f prime. We approximate the derivative of the function f, which we already know by f prime, by a first order Taylor approximation, which then of course there's one half missing. There's my one half. Or did I somehow get? There's no one half missing. I always get confused there. This is a first order Taylor approximation of f prime. And of course, a first order Taylor approximation usually involves function itself plus the derivative of it times the difference between the expansion point and the value itself. And here, because the function for which we do the first order Taylor approximation is already the derivative, this is why we here have the second derivative, which makes it look a little bit like a second order Taylor approximation, but it is not one. We approximate, or the idea of Newton-Raphson is to approximate the derivative of f, for which we want to find a zero, by a first order Taylor approximation, and then to solve this analytically. So that's the idea. So the trick is then that you want to find a point for which this thing here, so I'm calling this theta tilde, could also call it theta star, maybe I call it theta star because I just called it theta star, equals zero. Yeah, so this is kind of the approximated zero of first derivative. Now, somehow we want to find a zero of the first derivative. It's not really clear how we should do that. Newton-Raphson proposes, okay, we find a zero of a first order Taylor approximation to the first derivative, because we can actually do this analytically. And maybe let's do that before the break. So we now want to actually solve this equation here for theta star, and this one can readily do by basically filling in what f tilde prime is, namely it's f tilde theta k is the expansion point. And this is set to 0. And now we have to solve this for theta star. And of course, we can first put the f prime theta k to the other side. So we get f theta k theta star minus theta k equals minus f prime theta k. And then we can divide by the second derivative. Expansion point, and then we can take this to the other side. And this is then the 0 of this approximate first derivative. Well, so we can find a 0 of this approximate first derivative based on some value theta k by taking theta k and subtracting from it the value of the function f prime at the location theta k divided by the second derivative. And this then is the basic idea for this algorithm. So we do that once, but we have approximated it, and maybe we are not really at a zero yet, so we do it again and again and again, and we get to the Newton-Raphson update. Which is just what we've just written, but for the next, so for k plus 1, we use what we derived here, theta k minus f prime theta k divided by f2 theta k. And we do this until f prime theta k plus 1 equals 0, because then we have found a 0 of the derivative, which then hopefully corresponds to a maximum of our original function. Yeah, so this is the Newton-Raphson update rule, again, which derives from approximating the derivative. And I think this is a good time for a break. And after the break, I show you a picture that shows what's happening there. And then we can generalize this easily to multivariate Newton-Raphson, and then can easily generalize this to to Fisher scoring. And then we are done. Yeah. Okay, so let's have a break if there are no current questions. No? Good.